Look how obnoxious this color combo is. I look like a mascot, like a lame mascot. Hey YouTube, Awesome Writer here. Welcome to my review for King Oger 46. And broken record here, King Oger remains the worst show I've ever seen. Now, you know, guys, King Oger's been great. I almost wish it wouldn't have a good episode because I'm tired of coming here sounding like a broken record. I want to start by saying, this is probably one of the best first-parters I've ever seen to a toku story. As toku fans, we know two-parters are part of the DNA often, especially in Rider. But you know those episodes where either you watch it or you review it and you say, that was a good setup episode, but you know, not a lot to say because it was a setup episode. And this was simultaneously a setup episode for Fury of the Gods 2, The Streets. Speaking of, seriously, Fury of the Gods Shazam was not that bad. People, like, seriously, it's a fun movie. It not only sets up that, but it manages to tell a complete story thematically all on its own about death, which was actually pretty deep. I mean, it's not necessarily a new story. I've definitely seen this story done before, where the core, like, thesis statement is that quote by Ultron, which is, a thing isn't beautiful because it lasts. That's basically what it is, and I've seen that story before, but surprisingly deep for Sentai. I couldn't help but think about how there's that rumor that Boom Boonger's gonna go more silly and childish because Sentai likes to age up with his audience to a degree and then go back, and how this is dealing with some pretty mature stuff, and if that's true, I'm definitely gonna miss that. And I also don't know why you don't wanna just target all the kids at once. I mean, why you don't wanna just, like, target all, you know, the broad kid audience from young kid to old kid. Anyway, that's a discussion for a different time. Basically, we were kind of doing these, like, character-focused chunks, where last week was Kaguragi and Rita, and this week is Himeno and Jeremy. And they kind of pivot where you'd think that Himeno would be working with Juru because... Juru? Did I just travel back to Kara Major times? Himeno and Gira, because focuses on Grody, who can't die, and then they realize that Grody actually is similar to what Gira could have been, as Rackleys is like, yeah, he done ate a shirt ton of shoe gods and basically ate so much he lost himself like he feared Gira would, and like, that's why he covets death. It's kind of like a dark foreshadowing for what Gira could have been, which was an unexpected and cool connection. So initially, of course, they draw the similarity of I need to work with / study Gira, but then they say, like, no, you're gonna work with Jeremy because they reveal that Jeremy's secret power is, like, everyone has their power, and they didn't think Jeremy had one because his ancestor was banished, but then Rackleys is like, no, retcon, they let him go because he had a secret power they wanted to keep hidden, and his hidden power is immortality, which makes sense because, you know, that's kind of been a thing we've talked about, is his immortality. And so they have them work together instead. It does make me curious, like, obviously this worked really well thematically, but it makes me curious, like, what Gira's focus is gonna be. Is he gonna be off on his own? Or are they gonna maybe do a Gira Rackleys thing? I don't know, we'll have to see. Regardless though, they have those two working together on trying to figure out how to defeat Grody, and it brings up the themes about death, where of course Himeno, both having suffered loss and like not wanting to experience that and understanding that, and also being a doctor and seeing loss, thinks that immortality would be a gift and wants to live in a world where you can just resurrect everyone and everyone lives forever. And then, of course, you have Jeremy, who's lived forever, and you have that classic, like, immortal, like, you know, is a long life really that good? You know, couldn't help but make me think of the 10th Doctor's line of, you just get tired of the struggle. That wasn't even a British accent. Doctor Who's been on my mind because I've been on a rewatch. I mean, like, how great was 10? Like, it's one of those ones where you think, like, yeah, he's so overrated, everyone talks about him too much, but then you watch it and it's like, damn, he really is that good, though. I also do find it funny, like, how many stories I've seen that talk about the psychological aspect of immortality of, like, oh, but then you see so many people die and life loses all meaning, but it's like, there's no immortals to give that perspective. I mean, I guess, you know, life's not that great. But you know what I mean? It is kind of a funny thing that's dived deep into as if there's actually an immortal psyche to get into. But I think it's all about, of course, appreciating the brevity of life and kind of a lesson that can be applied to a lot of things is less is more. It's like the toku team-ups. We do so many of them now, they're not special anymore. Or, you know, if your favorite cake, you had it every day, suddenly it's not special. You know, if everyone's super, no one will be. That type of thing. The idea of something being more brief and limited makes it more special, you know. I also couldn't help but think of the Doctor Strange quote of life isn't beautiful because it's long, it's because, you know, it's special because we know our time is short. I thought it was a really deep message. I thought it was well done, well conveyed, and well acted by the characters as they kind of discover and go on this journey together of ultimately Jeremy, I think, basically becoming mortal now because he gives it up, and Himeno sort of all understanding that lesson I was just talking about through all those pop culture examples. She basically sat down, watched a couple of video essays on Doctor Strange 1, the 10th Doctor, the end of Age of Ultron, and she's like, I got it, now we're good. That's exactly what happened in the episode. Don't even go watch it, just trust my word. But basically, the ultimate solution to defeating him, or like in this episode, attacking him more so, is rather than kill him, because he can't be killed. That's how the episode starts off, is Himeno's power was to, like, slice something with life, and it can't because he's dead, is to give him life, which is given via Jeremy's, like, immortal crystal. But then, of course, he survived because he's, like, alive now. I guess that's how it works. And he starts up Theory of the Gods, too. This was such a great episode. It was such a good, like, character-driven episode, and yet very story-driven, because we're dealing with Grodi, who's one of the most major villains. It had a major revelation about how Grodi works, which made him even more fascinating, which is so good. And like I said, my favorite thing about the episode is that it sets up Fury of the Gods 2 next week, which gets me super pumped because it looks like it's gonna be awesome. But also, just standalone, it was great. Like, I felt like I watched a complete story in regards to the theme they were telling, which I thought was really cool. I also had a small note on here that I just wanted to bring up, which I thought was kind of nice, was this moment where when Jeremy and Rackley's are talking and Rackley's reveals about his power, he's like burying the dead and he's like, oh, I'm teaching the Bugnarok about how to appreciate life and death, and which obviously tied into the theme, but I like little touches like that that go into Jeremy running the kingdom and the Bugnarok being a part of the ecosystem of all the kingdoms, which is crazy because, like, the Bugnarok were the henchmen and the villains in the beginning, and now they're, like, part of society. I really like that, and it just reminds me that Witcher is a series that I would totally read, like, expanded lore or watch, like, miniseries about, because there's so much stuff going on in regards to the kingdoms and characters and what characters did in the past that you just don't always have time to sit with, and it's like, there's little stuff like that that I appreciate. Overall, really strong episode, probably one of my favorites in more recent times. You know, we're gearing up for the finale and things have been really good, but what did you think of this episode? Did it give you an existential crisis? Let me know in the comments as always. Until next time, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and climb the steps and ring that bell so you can get notifications for all my videos. Dawson Ryder, signing out.